The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Welcome to worship here at Covenant Presbyterian on this Transfiguration Sunday. My name is Leigh Campbell-Taylor, and as of now, I am delighted to be one of your pastors. Even though we can't all be in the same place together, I'm so glad you've come to worship today. Here in the sanctuary with me is Pastor Kate, along with Jeffrey McIntyre and our wonderful staff singers, and Allison Kaufman, our lay lector, and then our technical team led by Steve Byerly, who make it possible for us to participate in this way. If you're joining via Facebook Live, please let us know you're here and send along any prayer requests. And then share our service on your page so that your friends can join too. This is a small thing that you can do and possibly have a big impact. Mentioning our wonderful singers reminds me that last week an obituary in the AJC caused a good bit of alarm in our community. So I want to assure you that Covenant's longtime soprano, Jean Ann, did not die, thanks be to God. Due to COVID precautions, she is not singing with us, and we're working on a suitable way to celebrate her years of service. But for now, we rejoice that Jean Ann is alive and well. There are two events that I want to remind you of for this coming week. This afternoon, please come to the church parking lot between 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock. We have a special Lenten packet that Kate and Lauren have put together for you to make this upcoming season more meaningful. And our youth group is collecting goods for lost and found youth. They need warm socks and gloves, food and personal items. A full list of all of this is in this week's e-blast. And I'll also get to see you this afternoon, at least to wave, and that would help me get to know you better. So the other thing to note is that this Wednesday evening, we will have an Ash Wednesday service at 7 o'clock. Please tune in for that. We'll share music. We will focus on Psalm 51. And we'll use the ashes that are included in your Lenten packet. All of this is part of the life of this congregation. But right now, our purpose is to turn our hearts to the worship of Almighty God.
On a high mountain, Jesus was transfigured, and God said, "This is my beloved Son. Let us worship God."
Thank you. We make poor choices. We believe we are without sin because we try to do the right thing, and yet we are reminded that we are broken people in broken systems that we continue to break. So I invite you to join with me as we confess that brokenness before God and each other. Please join me in our prayer of confession. God of compassion, in Jesus Christ, you reveal the light of your glory, but we turn away, distracted by our own plans. We confess that we speak when we should listen, and we act impulsively when we should pause to discern your will. Forgive our aimlessness. Grant us wisdom to live in your light and to follow in the way of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The God whom we see most clearly in the person of Jesus Christ is the God of compassion who loves us, forgives us, and strengthens us to grow in faithfulness. I declare to you that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And now as forgiven people, we share that peace with one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
The first reading is from Psalm 50, verses 1 to 6. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and does not keep silence. Before God is a devouring fire, and a mighty tempest all around. God calls to the heavens above and to the earth, that God may judge God's people. Gather to me, my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare God's righteousness, for God, God's very self, is judge.
Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our rock and our redeemer. To many of us, the word transfiguration means something now that it didn't mean 23 years ago, which is to say, before the advent of Harry Potter. Because among all the colorful characters introduced by those books, there is Minerva McGonagall, who teaches transfiguration. Now, before Professor McGonagall came on the scene, training young witches and wizards to turn mice into snuff boxes, transfiguration was better known through its churchy meaning, namely that bizarre occasion related in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, when Jesus, atop an unnamed mountain, is, in the words of the gospel writers, metamorphothi, metamorphosized, transfigured. Now, Harry Potter was very big in my household, but I still welcome this opportunity to reclaim and proclaim the church's understanding of transfiguration, which I hope we'll keep in mind as we hear this morning's gospel reading. You see, the Bible does not present transfiguration as having anything to do with turning mice into snuff boxes. If you hear nothing else this morning, hear this. In his transfiguration, Jesus is not turned from something he wasn't into something else. Rather, Jesus' transfiguration reveals who Jesus most truly is. And that's why our church calendar celebrates Transfiguration on this particular Sunday. This is the completion of the season of Epiphany and of the purpose of Epiphany, which is the revelation of Jesus, the Christ. Think of the star revealing his birth to the Magi. Think of the dove revealing his identity at his baptism. Think of Anna and Simeon in the temple, revealing his importance to them. And today, Transfiguration is the ultimate big reveal of Jesus Christ. And that matters as we stand here together on the threshold of Lent. Over the next 7 weeks, as we journey toward Jerusalem and the crucifixion that stands between us, looms between us now and Easter morning, I pray we all hold on to the faith-fortifying vision of Jesus' transfiguration. This is from the 9th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, beginning with the 2nd verse. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And then a cloud overshadowed them. And from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This too is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Bottom line, that day was different. I say this as an insider who had several mountaintop experiences with Jesus. That one was different. And all these years later, I'm still trying to understand it. I mean, Jesus had always been out of the ordinary, out of the blue. Some people told us he was out of his mind. We disciples were clear on maybe one thing. There was something about him. I mean, I'm not someone who drops my net and abandons my father in a fishing boat every day, you know. But Jesus' invitation, his command, maybe it was even a dare, his words, "Follow me." Well, it's quite a call. Being with him from the start, we, Peter and his brother and my brother and me, we saw it all. And sometimes we'd actually say to each other, "What are we doing here?" But other people's reactions to Jesus pretty well justified our own. You need to understand this. They loved him. Well, except for the ones who hated him. But, you know, I don't even think about them anymore. I mean, they are just totally not the point. No, I think of the awe and gratitude as Jesus healed person after person. The tears of wonder when someone could suddenly walk again, work again. The shouts of joy when someone could suddenly see or hear. Men, women, old, young. I was in the room where it happened, but I had no idea about Jesus' power. Now the demons, they did know his power. The demons knew Jesus better than we did. And I still don't know what to make of that. But if you've ever seen someone possessed by an evil so that they have lost themselves, their self has been stolen, and then to see Jesus restore them, it still takes my breath away. And then Jesus sent us out in the world to do it too. Don't take any luggage or any money, just go heal the world. And for a little while we did. But Jesus wasn't only healing. There were these massive crowds, and Jesus would notice that they were probably getting hungry. So he'd look right at us. "How much bread you got?" "I don't know, 2, 4, 5 loaves." I mean, seriously, what did it matter? There was no way to have enough for all those people. And then he'd say, "Got any fish?" And he looked so expectant, like a couple of fish were going to feed the masses. And yet he could make it enough. Oh, and he could flat shut down a storm, seriously. I mean, the winds and the waves obeyed him. There is no other way to say it. Never mind the fact that he could actually walk on top of the water. That totally freaked us out. I tell you all this because Jesus was really something. We just didn't know what. And I can see how he tried to tell us, but it's so hard to hold his truth in your mind. Do you feel that way? He must have known we were clueless because he finally just up and asked us, "Who do you say that I am?" And we all fumbled around with stupid guesses until Peter blurted out, "You are the Messiah." Nailed it, Peter did. Peter. There was a lot to say about Peter. And that particular day said almost all of it. Somehow Peter got the right answer. Jesus was the Messiah. But then Jesus starts explaining that the Messiah must suffer and be killed, which was news to us. And so Peter starts doing really loud whispering at him, trying to get him to stop talking like that. And Jesus just lets Peter have it. So we're all standing there, looking at our sandals, thinking how glad we are that Peter is our designated over-functioner. And before we know it, Jesus has gathered everyone within earshot and is telling them and us that his "follow me" message isn't just an invitation to excitement. It's also a command, and maybe a dare, to lose our ordinary lives as the only way to save them. He must have known he'd freaked us out because Jesus left us on our own for the next 6 days. 6 days, enough time for God to create all that is good, and enough time for Peter to bounce back to his usual over-functioning self. And so that's when Jesus gathers us, the three of us, and with no explanation, we head up the mountain, and suddenly, Jesus is, I don't know how to say it, he is metamorphosis. He's himself, only more so. And his clothes are like they are made out of light. It hurts to look at them. But we can't not look at them because all of a sudden Moses and Elijah are standing there talking with him. I guess I thought we were Jesus's pals, his confidants, his, I don't know, sounding board. But no, Jesus is consulting with Moses and Elijah, the law and the prophets. The ancient faith of our people, stretching all the way from the Exodus to the promises of God. Like I said, that day was different. Jesus chatting with Moses and Elijah. Maybe they commiserated over what dimwits people can be, or maybe they compared notes about what it's like to spend your life doing the will of God. Who knows? I was too stupefied to eavesdrop. But Peter, you gotta hand it to him. Peter actually butts in right into their conversation. Rabbi, since we're here too, we could, you know, whip up some little tents for y'all. You wanna laugh, but bless his heart. At least he was trying. Me, I was shaking so badly I was useless. And then this cloud, and then this voice you could feel as much as hear. This is my beloved son. Listen to him. And then it's over. As suddenly and inexplicably as it started, it ended. Now, Jesus had stunned us before. Walking on water, giving sight to the blind. But I guess I'd thought that it was all, I don't know, magic or something. But this, I keep saying it, this was different. This was God's Son revealed on earth. He told us not to breathe a word of it until he'd risen from the dead, and I didn't. Not because I excel at listening to him, but because I didn't have words for it. But ever since, I've been trying to make sense of it. What made that day different was that it revealed how different Jesus is. It revealed him as the culmination of God's whole history with God's people. It revealed that Jesus wasn't just another preacher or teacher. He wasn't just some miracle worker or a really good example. No, Jesus is different. He is one of us, and he is the Son of God. Which means that what he says and does is different. He's not just being helpful or nice or something. He's working God's own will. And knowing that makes us, all of us who, however cluelessly, seek to follow Jesus, it makes us different too. Because we can know when we keep working for Jesus' demand that the hungry have food, that the sick receive care, that everybody is known to be a beloved child of God. All of that really matters. Because when you follow Jesus' words and ways, you are living your life in response to his call, responding to his "follow me" is the start of losing your ordinary life as the only way to save it. Because Jesus is the Son of God, the one who came to live with us and die for us, when we follow him, especially on that hard road to Jerusalem, it makes us different too. Amen.
In response to hearing God's word read and proclaimed, this is an opportunity for all of us to return to God a portion of what God has given to each and every one of us.
Oh,
I invite you all to quiet your hearts, settle in to wherever you are sitting or watching, and become the body of prayer spread all over Atlanta and all over the country and beyond. Let us pray. God of all creation, as the sun rises each morning, we have the opportunity to be aware that you gently lift the veil of doubts and fears from our hearts, that we might see your joy. Help us that when we open our eyes, we might see Moses and Elijah and the shimmering light around Jesus, to see your word restoring us and showing us the way, telling a story, your story, his story, our story. We wish we could live on mountaintops, basking always in your glory, rather than in the ordinary days of these lives. And yet, we find ourselves blessed by communities of faith and in the community of your Son, who helps us see you. Help us to look for you among people, those who do not have power or rights or voice, to see you among those who live on the streets of our city, whose housing is inadequate, who don't know where their next meal is coming from, or whose homes are not safe. Help us to look for you among those who grieve for the loss of a loved one, for the loss of a livelihood, for the loss of a future unrealized. You meet us in the broken places and shine the light of Christ into our lives. Help us to carry that light into the dark places and share it with those we meet. And help us, especially as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, this Wednesday, ashes on the forehead may mark us as different, but I invite you to go out into this week knowing that Jesus invites us to live differently, following him as the one who shows us the way. And as you go, may you know the love of the one true God, who is the source, the Son, and the Spirit, this day and always. Amen. Thank you.